Father, we thank you for this day, dear God. We thank you that we can see that this is the day of me that we will rejoice and be glad in. We thank you for everything that has taken place in the service before and has gone before, dear God. And we pray, dear Father, as we bring forth this message this morning, God, that you are going to bless the word of God in the hearers. And you are going to give me clarity of speech and thought, dear God, to deliver it just as you have given it to me. I want you to turn your Bible to Luke chapter 1. Luke chapter 1. And we're looking at specifically verse 37.
Mary was puzzled indeed.
And then the angel goes on to tell her, with God, nothing shall be impossible. And somehow, those words seem to soothe her spirit and settle her mind. With God, nothing shall be impossible. That settled it for Mary. She knew within her spirit then and there that this was something out of the ordinary. Firstly, an angel visited her. Then the way he greeted her. She knew that this was a message that came from God himself. What was her response? She said, "Be it unto me according to your word." Even though she initially had a doubt, even though she had a concerns, she was saying, "How can this be?" But the Holy Spirit came upon her even from then and soothed her spirit, soothed her doubts, soothed her fears, and brought her to the point where she could say, "Be it unto me according to your word." Oh, that we could have that kind of faith, that we could have that kind of trust and confidence in what the Lord says. Let's look at another situation. Matthew chapter 14, verses 22 to 36. In this account we have, what is happening here is that Jesus had just finished preaching, and he told his disciples to go ahead, go on over to the other side, and he would catch up with them. He wanted to stay and pray for a while. So they got on the boat to cross over onto the other side. Midway over, storm came up. Now I don't know how many of you all have ever traveled between Trinidad and Tobago. How many of you know about the waves that come outside there? I am telling you, there are times when you could be in the boat and looking up at the waves. Because it goes deep down and then you go higher. Real, huge waves. A couple of years ago, I went to there and took a boat from the Essequibo River. And the Essequibo is one of the smaller rivers in South America, but it's 25 miles wide. Picture that, 25 miles wide. And when Sister Jackie saw the state of the river and the wind pulled up on that thing, well, Jackie looked at him, Jackie stood up on the pier and looked at the thing and said, "Oh Jesus." Because she knew she had to get in a boat and go up that river. We had to travel for about an hour and a half up the river on that. So that was nothing like I expect what they experienced on that boat. I'm telling you, I am sure those fellows were really scared. They were really frightened. But then they looked down over the waters and they saw what looked like a man walking towards them, walking on the water. And if they were scared then, I am sure they were more scared now. I have heard stories of fishermen about things that they see when they go outside. Yeah, they see all sorts of things. Fellas, tell you about the place getting very still. Very, very still. And sometimes they even whistle when they breathe. And it happens. But they get some really spooky things happening out there. So imagine that they are out in the middle of the sea. Waves tossing left and right, and this, what probably looked like an apparition coming towards them, walking on water. first place they probably think this is an impossibility. Nobody could walk on water. Nothing could float on water except a boat. But then they look a little more closely and they realize that it was Jesus. But you know, that realization didn't seem to be enough for Peter. Peter wanted proof. So he said, "Master, if it's really you, if it is really you, then tell me to come to you on the water." Means he said, "Jesus, if this is really you, let me walk on the water to uncover the nature." Jesus said, "Come." And you know what? He started off well enough. He stepped out of the boat and he started to walk out. I got to walk like old Brother James might have illustrated with. Start to walk. Walk with purpose. Started to walk towards Jesus. But what happened? Started to look at the waves. Started to look at the waves. Look at the waves. And in doing so, he took his eyes off of Jesus. And what happened? He became fearful and he started sick. He became fearful. But you know what? He still had enough sense to cry out, "Lord, save me!" Still had enough sense to do that. Going down, but he said, "Lord, save me." And Jesus chastised him immediately, saying, "Oh, thou of little faith, why did you doubt? Why did you doubt?" And then he stretched out his hand and saved him. So what can you learn from this? I'll tell you what I learned. When Jesus tells you to do something, do it. Jesus told him to come. That's what he was supposed to do. Just come to Jesus. Don't waver in your faith. Don't take your eyes off of the goal. Don't doubt. Even when the going gets rough and tough, the tough gets going. When the going gets tough, the tough gets going. Let me switch gears a little bit here. We recently had a very important service here. It was held in September, where we commemorated, you'll see the sign up here, 45 years of full-time ministry for Pastor Hart. And that's a major landmark by any standard. Pastor Hart is the man that God has placed over us to bring His message to us, to bring God's message to us. God has given him the pastor, the vision for this church. And he continues to give him the vision and instruction. The pastor prayerfully interprets that vision and then communicates it to the congregation. Our responsibility in the congregation is, with God's help and guidance, and the pastor's guidance, to accomplish that vision. So we are therefore responsible to help and to cooperate in the fulfilling of the God-given vision for this church. Stick with me, I'm going somewhere with this. There have been times when, in the course of his sermon, Pastor Hart would talk about things he would like to see happen or accomplish. And really, you have to be listening to his sermons, to his messages, to pick up on these things. But I dare say, those are not merely his thoughts. spends a lot of time in prayer before he comes to this congregation with anything. And I can give you one example from recent times. This was from probably 2 years ago, our admission service, when he issued a challenge to the leaders of the various ministries. I don't know how many of you will remember this. He said, spoke about discover, develop, and deploy. Discover, develop, and deploy. And that is in keeping with our mission to reach the teach and train and to appoint and serve. At this year's appreciation service, when he had to bring his remarks, he dropped another one. And I don't think I would speak it out of tune when I share this. How many of you know that in addition to this building and this land that Chile sits on, that we also have another pastoral land on this side? You all aware of that? Everybody aware of that? But I know some people were not really aware of that. But it's the pastor's vision to erect a building on that pastor land adjacent to this building. That building would house a multi-purpose hall, various other rooms, and our much-needed car park facilities. And it's a big vision. It's a huge project. Huge project. And I have to confess that sometimes I am like Peter. Pastor, sometimes I am like Peter. I sometimes look at waves. I look at the big waves that will surround this vision. But then I hear a voice inside of me say, "Only a little faith. Why do you doubt? Why do you doubt? Trust me. Haven't I done it before? Didn't I see about these chairs in the church? Didn't I see about repairing the ceiling? Didn't I see about all of that?" Those are merely examples of what God can do. Mere examples of what he can do. What is he? Just trust me. Tell me. Trust me. Obey me. Don't doubt. I'm reminded of the account of Jesus' first miracle. How many of you know what Jesus' first miracle was? Didn't want it to wine. Big, big wedding. All the important people in this wedding. From the governor of the big, big wedding. And what could happen? Horror of all horrors. They ran out of wine. Poor fellow, don't know what to do. Till to Mary. Told Mary what the problem was. And you know what? The first thing Mary did, she took the workers to Jesus. She went to Jesus. She took the workers with her. And what she told the workers, whatever he tells you to do, do it. Just do it. And you know, they were asking for wine. I don't know what they expected, but Jesus told the workers, fill the jars with water. in blindness. They must have whispered among themselves, this is a madman. Here it is, we want wine, and he is saying, put forth any chance, put forth any chance. Nevertheless, they did what they were told. They obeyed. And lo and behold, when they went to serve the guests, they came out with wine. And so it was the best wine they served that they kept for us. You know, I can well imagine that in the early days, when Pastor had this vision, when God spoke to him about building that, putting up that building next door there, Pastor must have questioned God about it. He must have wrestled with it quite a lot. He would have spent a lot of time, as he does, in prayer before God, before coming to anybody. And generally, he would talk to the board police and then talk to the congregation. But you know, after all the prayer, it would have been settled in his spirit at some point that this is indeed what the Lord is saying. This is what the Lord wants us to do. And that's why he is confident in sharing this vision with us. As I said, he spent a lot of time in prayer. Goes before God so that we are sure that his decisions are God-directed decisions. And that holds true for a number of other things that Pastor comes with. And so when we get these messages from Pastor, what is our responsibility? If you have doubts in your mind as to the project or whatever it is that Pastor is covering, if you have doubts in your mind about it, you need to get that settled in your spirit. And how do you do that? You go and talk to God about it as well. You go and pray about it, and then God settle that in your spirit. You see, many times you have a tendency to go and talk to somebody else. You go and whisper to somebody about the fears that you may have concerning something. And unwittingly, you are also fueling their fears, their doubts. So, I am putting it to you this morning, the correct thing to do, go to God, talk to him about it. Let him calm your fears. So the question now is, what is our response to the pastor's vision? What is our response to the pastor's vision? When we ask, like Mary, how can this be? You may look around and see our congregation seems to be declining. We have less numbers. And we want to go into a mammoth construction project. And you may ask, how can this be? Would we like Peter look at the waves? All the waves of negativity. And begin to doubt. What would be our response? Would we say like Mary did eventually? Be it unto me according to thy word. Mary recognized that the angel was a messenger from God, with a message from God to her. Just as our pastor is a messenger from God to his congregation. He is the person that God speaks through to give direction to this congregation. So what are we supposed to do? Support the vision. Support the vision and work hand in hand with him to have the vision accomplished. We have to be united on this. We cannot have any division. We have to work together as a team. What is a team? A team is a group of people working together towards a common goal. So we are either supporting the vision or we are promoting division. We don't want anybody in here to be promoting division. We either support division. So remember, don't look at the waves. Don't look at the waves. Even in your own life, don't look at the waves. What God says to you, do it. What God says to you, do it. Does that always say something? Don't look at the bigness of the task. Don't look at the bigness of the project. And she always has to remind me about it. Because I will go to her and sit down and give all the reasons why we cannot do something. She's the one who says, don't look at the bigness of the task. What are we going to look at? She says about the pulpit all the time. Look at the bigness of your God. Look at the bigness of your God. So in closing, I want to repeat, and I want you to repeat with me the verse that we started off with. What was it? For with God, and we're going to change it from shall be to is. So let's stand and we are going to repeat that over. Said a few times, for with God nothing is impossible. For with God nothing is impossible. I want you to say it like you believe it.
For with God nothing is impossible.
For with God
nothing is impossible.
Say it again.
For with God nothing is impossible.
And say it again.